named George in Alabama, and countless others. I had started out searching for my country and myself, and found both. What's more, and well, without expecting or deserving it, I had come face to face with God and accepted Him as my own. And more and much more was still to come. The practical side of it hit us all only gradually. Me, in the middle of a 5,000-mile walk, Mary, a gentle belle, who had never camped out in her life, would this scholarly seminarian be willing and able to walk with me for 3,000 miles under a full pack and throughout who know what hardships and dangers? We walked our final mile on July 18th, 1979. We stopped in Florence, Oregon, so that our families and some of our friends we had met over the past 5 years and 4,750 miles could join us for the final steps. About 150 people came, including Barbara's 83-year-old grandmother, Viola Pennell, who led us at her own pace over the grassy dunes. Before the final dune, she stopped for a moment, pulled a small brown bottle from her purse, jiggled out a tiny white nitroglycerin pill, and popped it under her tongue. As we approached the ocean's foaming surf, Barbara and I moved away from the crowd. The vast Pacific rolled right up to greet us, a blue and sparkling welcome mat that was just the right size to fit our feelings. When we got to the edge of the water, we couldn't stop. We kept on walking right up to our waist. Everyone was yelling, laughing, crying, and hugging each other, especially Barbara and me. We had done what we set out to do and much more. Our own personal odyssey had somehow come to have a special significance for all these wonderful, laughing people around us. I knew the God who had guided this walk was guiding us still. I started off disillusioned and without hope, and now I have an unshakable love for my country. Although I lost my forever friend Cooper, I found the one eternal love of my life, Barbara, and now we are being blessed with a child to share the America we had found. The waves were really cold, our legs were turning numb. We slogged back out onto the shore to begin the rest of our lives. I think we're here today to witness another beginning of a walk, the walk of Lana and Mike. And I know all of us that have known them are blessed because we've been able to share their love and their friendship. All I can say is let the walk begin. And Mr. Hugh Whitman.
Not having known Lana for too long, I sat down one time and I said, okay, tell me. Because I wanted to write something to Lana and to Mike. Lana, I pieced together from sketchy knowledge of you these papier-mâché bits into an imperfect statue. I may have put a little of my own boyhood and memories having grown up in the east of the Blue Ridge Mountains in Virginia, but hopefully it fits, and most of this is what Lana said. A slender blonde little girl skipped down the gravel road swinging a book satchel to school. I think you can see it over here. On Saturdays, about once a month, she went to the store for books from the bookmobile because she read books. And Lana breathed in these mountains, the pine needles, the oak trees. The sun warmed the summer fields. Peace and love and the country warmed her heart. She sang to her dog, and he sang back. And they raced over the hills. They lay down in the clover quilts and looked up at the pillows of cloud shifting and turning on the bright blue bed of sky. You can do that today if you want. That cloud there, it's a lion. Then it shifts and becomes a giant to get you. And then it stretches out and broadens and it becomes a whale and so on and so on. Barefoot in March, stepping on a honeybee and limping back home with the stinger still in. Warm and loving parents and a wide windowsill to sit on and read the books. Then a run to the mailbox to get the paper for her brother so she could read the funnies first, but no, he took them and read them first instead. And that's probably a surprise to somebody. I may have to run at it. What a shame. On seesaw Saturday nights, a full bath in a zinc wash tub and a two-seater outhouse with Sears Roebuck. or literature and anything else that is needed, and much more. From a longhouse to a degree in business management to Chicago and Eastman Kodak in Kingsport, Tennessee, and back here. And when I met you 2 years ago, Lana, I discovered your interest in writing and hiking and biking and some other things. And Mike said, there's this neat woman in my creative writing class. What's her name? Lana? Mike? And Lana, once you read aloud, shyly, in your beautiful Tennessee dialect, under our willow tree, a poem that you had written, and so on. Mike, the new teacher in the reading center had taught at Evanston Township High School, had a master's degree, tall, basketball player, jogger. How'd you do it? And when we jogged, talking in bursts with our puffing breath, the first mile was easier for me than you on your cardboard knees, Mike. But oh, then the last mile of four killed me and you simply ran off and left me. Age could have something to do with it. And Mike, life is a jogging, a hanging in there when you can't and when you don't feel like it, and you did, and you do. As a coach of student congress, the kids learned a lot from you. A lot is two words, remember? That's the red mark. How to think, how to be logical. If this is true and that is true, then what conclusions can we draw? Prima facie, three-point speech, signposting, two-thirds majority votes, and your demands on the students. You took no crap, you held them to their word. A fine learning for them. And all this from Kewanee, Illinois, the hog capital of the world? He told me that. I said, Mike, call a pig or two for us so we know if you're telling the truth. Son of a teacher? Kay, with an E. And Daryl, the farmer, the mechanic, Mr. Fix-It. Daryl, we should get together. I'm Mr. Break-It. Mike, in tribute to Kay and Daryl and to a small community in northwestern Illinois, said he had a Walt Disney childhood. Life didn't really hit him until he left. And then I guess it did, as it does all of us. But even with harsh reality hitting him in the face, he is still alive and kicking and believing and loving. Imagine a community in this complex modern world where kids go through grade school and high school and college and graduate together. Mike was one of five, he told me, that did all of that from the very beginning. That's some kind of a record, I think. And Mike, you are a son to me, a brother to me, sometimes, yeah, maybe a father to me. No generation gap. Both Mike and Lana from the farm with the chores, with the slopping of hogs. You have to be from the South to say hogs right, you know what I mean? A hoe in the fields, the hard work, the blistered hands, the tired backs, and the clean satisfaction that only physical work can give. You both know this. And now the mental work to sharpen the brain, like filing a paring knife to a sharp edge, and always so much more. And finally, just a comment or two as you look toward the future. Here is a hope and a prayer for you too, Mike and Lana, that you may find challenge, fulfillment, and working, playing, making and creating in your own ways out of the special self that is Mike, the special self that is Lana, that you will find strength in your faith and goodness in people everywhere, because there are good people everywhere. Find them, and the prayer is that you may find love in the living of life, in your friends and each other, that you may experience moments of total joy in the big happenings that await you. And at times, joy for no other reason but that the sun came up this morning. And that the earth smells good after a rain. Joy from other people, from the hills, the trees. May you find also strength to weather the moments when things are not the way you want them to be. You too can do all of these things, Mike and Lana, because you're just the type.
and the woman will agree. Companionship has made her feel so complete with you and me. And the Lord up above, we have security, we have security. You fill my life with so much joy, I can't even remember how I was before. Though sometimes we disagree, you still know that I love you and you love me. With you and me and the Lord up above, we have security, we have security. What God has joined together, let no man put asunder. Nothing can separate you from me. I'll worship and adore you, put no one else before you. This is my vow to you, my love, to all eternity. Love was made in heaven before the world began. Though sometimes we disagree, I pray that all we hope for will come true. With you and me and the Lord up above, have security.
Take a minute now and pay a little tribute to our parents. And that's really impossible to do, as any child knows. But I'm going to give a try here. We love our parents for many reasons and many things they've done for us, and I'd like to encapsulate that. And I think the greatest thing we could say is we love them because they showed us how to live through example and not just words. They showed us through the example of hard work. We both grew up on farms, and there's no way to escape that. But we saw our parents work hard, and we saw